Welcome to our second group session. If you just want to like go ahead and introduce yourself and just get right into it.
Yeah, should I start?
Yeah, sure.
Cool. Well, thanks everyone for coming. Sorry to keep you waiting. I'm at work and I was trying to find a good spot to do this. My name is Manuel Arturo Abreu. I'm a poet and artist from the Bronx, and I currently live and work in Portland. My practice uses text, ephemeral sculpture, photography, and whatever is at hand to engage the criticality of Blackness that I'm trying to reclaim from its whitewashed context. And I try to have fun. I used to work a lot with precarious materials, but now I have money for art materials, so it's kind of an interesting crisis of professionalism. But anyway, my talk today is going to be, so it's called The Spirit of the Micropayment, and it's going to be kind of an excursion or meditation on this idea from Ted Nelson about the micropayment. As the name kind of indicates, a micropayment is just a very small amount of money. In the specific context that he was thinking and working in the 60s before the internet, he imagined digital literature and literary activity online to be a system where every time someone is cited, they get paid some amount, some micropayment. And every time that users access content, the creator gets paid. This is kind of different. I mean, it sounds like what we have now, but it's different from things like subscription models or, you know, things like Patreon or freemium models. The micropayment is a really interesting concept to me, not only just technologically, but also from the perspective of social justice, I guess. As I wrote in the description on Facebook, Nelson's micropayment idea is pretty utopian. It's definitely colorblind. And in a very strange way, patriarchal. That's kind of a different lecture. I'll talk about that later. But by challenging the utopianism of his idea, I think that we can actually posit a structure for reparations and decolonization that uses the micropayment idea or criticizes the utopianism to make it better. So that's what my talk is about. You guys can interrupt me at any time and ask questions. Am I coming through okay?
Yeah, sounds good.
Mm-hmm. Cool. I didn't write anything, so I'm just going to talk. It might be a bit disorganized, but that's okay. So like I said, Ted Nelson came up with the idea of micropayments and hypertext as well. Hypertext is, you know, linked text on the internet that links to a different page. It's probably the most mundane concept today, but back then it was mind-blowing or whatever. And he has a quote that I have here. He said, "I came up with the idea of micropayment to make hypertext possible." So now today, obviously, hypertext has nothing to do with micropayments. It's just how you link to another web page, right? It's how you sell stuff. It's how you market, et cetera. But for him, the digital world that he was imagining included links that go both ways and not just forward. And it was a world in his mind where anyone would be able to publish and legally quote anyone's document with an automatic royalty deposited into their bank account every time their content is read. And obviously we live in a world today where content is supposed to be free. This is kind of a residue of 60s Silicon Valley utopianism, the idea that information wants to be free. It doesn't want to be controlled. Doesn't want to cost money. I actually strongly disagree with that. And I think that information wouldn't have to be free if people weren't impoverished. I think that we're used to treating information as free, but the price that we pay for that illusion, it only works as long as the overall economy isn't actually an information economy. Like, we think that we're living in a post-industrial world, but that's not really the case. We're just in a Western context where all of the industry is outsourced. So because of that illusion of freedom, or the illusion of the concept of information being free, people got kind of confused about what the economy looks like today. And I think that's a problem. I think we need to kind of rematerialize or think about the digital as a product of, or as a result of things like colonialism and anti-blackness and imperialism and misogyny. And I think that that's been happening already. It's not a new concept. I just think that people need to talk about it more. So the structure that I'm imagining is one where affect is financialized, right? Explore with the micropayment concept and critiquing its utopianism. I want to think about how the micropayment, and the micropayment specifically in today's world where affect itself is already financialized, like all of our social media activity is for the profit of these large digital corporations. So it's not as though affect isn't already financialized, because it is, but I think that we can recalibrate how we think about it, right? From the perspective of the imperative to pay what is owed, we can think about the financialization of affect in a positive way, not just from the perspective of they're stealing our surplus value, our sociality. Yeah?
Sorry, can you explain more what financialization of affect is?
Yeah, well, capitalism, as it develops, it goes deeper and deeper into the social and into the, I guess, personal. The public and private sphere doesn't really exist anymore, and capitalism has kind of made its way all the way down to the bottom of the body, so to speak, right? So our very thoughts are financialized in that sense. Financialization just means when a market or when an economy becomes financialized. It's not about material goods, it's about financial instruments, speculation, will to power, that kind of stuff. But I'm also using it just to mean monetization, I guess, if that makes sense. Yeah. Is that a good answer?
Yeah, thanks.
Okay, cool.
So examples of the financialization of affect would be like the ways that Facebook's response buttons change your feed. So if you're pressing angry on some sort of content, you're gonna see more of that content because it's not just the like. And if that content is something that's selling you something, you're gonna see a lot more ads in your feed, even if it's something you hate, right? So that's one example. But like I said, it's more constructive to not just despair that, but to think about how the financialization of affect can be good, right? And so what I'm imagining is a situation where everyone's bank account is linked to this system, right? This micropayment system, and affect itself is waged. That's my kind of ideal imaginary world, I guess, where every time that, for example, a black woman experiences a microaggression, she gets paid, right? This money's just put into her account from the person that did that. Now, of course, that entails this very intensive surveillance system, which is something that I think kind of goes hand in hand with financialization. Like, you can't make money off of affect and off of feelings if you don't have surveillance in place. So as much as I'm talking about the positive aspects of the financialization of affect, I'm aware that it's a problematic structure, and I'm going to talk about that a little more later in reference to the Wages for Housework campaign. Right, so financializing affect, and some sort of app that deposits money into your bank account based on your feelings, right? People with big feelings will have big bank accounts. Why is that interesting to me? Why does that appeal to me? Well, I did, for a few years, I was undergoing housing precarity, aka I was houseless, and was evicted from school for drugs and stuff. So what I was doing, based on this piece by Damali Ayo, which is called Living Flag, Panhandling for Reparations. It's a piece from 2007, which she performed in New York and Portland. She panhandled on the street, and then the money that she collected, she gave out to black people, other black people. And this was really interesting to me. So I started tweeting and posting on Facebook and other mediums about reparations and about people needing to give me money, needing to keep me alive, etc. And then with the money that I got, I would give it out to people, or, you know, I would buy myself food and pay rent and stuff, obviously. But whatever was left over, I would try to redistribute in the spirit of the Molly's Project. I'm considering playing it right now, but I don't know how much time y'all have. I can play an excerpt of it or something.
Yeah, if you can play
sure.
Something, that'd be cool.
Okay. Yeah, let's do it. Just because I think this piece is so important for the, I guess, the recent history of work, artwork around reparations. So I'll play just a few minutes of it, see if I can do this. Here we go. Okay. Are you guys hearing it?
No.
No.
Can you guys hear it?
No, we can't.
Shit, okay.
Do y'all want to pay some reparations today? Reparations, you can pay right here. Very simple.
How about now?
Yeah.
Is it clear?
Yeah, kind of.
Can't really play it too loud because I'm in my office, but let's see if this works.
Y'all want to pay some reparations? Reparations today? You can pay right here. It's very convenient. Hey, did you guys want to pay some reparations today? Hello. Would you like to make a reparations payment today? Do you want to pay some reparations today?
I'm totally sorry that people were enslaved.
Right, you can make a payment right here. Start today. You can write it off on your taxes.
I'm enslaved by the IRS.
Ooh.
Do you want to pay some reparations? Thanks, would you like a receipt? Did you give me 20 cents? How are you today? October 29th, 2003. Gosh. What's your name?
Tina.
Okay, so. Make sure you send that into the IRS.
Okay.
Thank you. Did you want a receipt?
Sure.
Okay. I'm sure it is. And then I will pay that to somebody else who comes by.
All right, let's watch a bit of her giving it out.
So $5, William.
$6, so I'll give it to you. So that's your answer. Your money goes to her. There you go. How are you doing? Yeah.
Reparation accepted here. What is that for?
Do you know what reparations are? So I've been accepting payments from white people for reparations for slavery. What do you think of that?
No, not bad.
Get the money. Yeah. There you go. No, this is from a white person to black people. Yeah. So do something good with it.
Oh, I will. Yeah.
Good. That's your first reparations payment. You have a good day. Well, I'm collecting from people. Did you want to make a reparations payment? Collecting from white people payments for black people. What do you think of that? You want one? Come here. Come here. There's your first reparations payment for slavery. Yeah. I'm giving money to you, yeah. There's no catch. Yeah. Your ancestors worked hard for that. You should get some money, right?
I got you the money back.
No, you can just keep going on. You have a good day.
All right. I encourage you guys to have a store. It'd be cool. Still with me?
Yeah. What was that artist's name?
Tamale Ayo. Oh, I can hear myself now. Oh, no. Okay, but so Tamale's piece, also her early work in general is really important. But that piece specifically, I think, spawned a pretty awesome ecosystem of work about or engaging in reparations. So some things that come to mind, for example, are like, you know, Pay Black Time by Rufino Santana, or Winslow LaRoche requesting reparations donations via Facebook Messenger. I'm going to talk a bit about other specific projects later. I just wanted to provide that context because I think it's important. And she really kind of started that, as far as I know. So I didn't realize, I'm thinking about it now, it's interesting that she mentioned the tax deductible thing, because that could maybe provide us a path toward thinking about this financialization of affect thing I'm talking about. Right? Like, what if there was a nonprofit? What if that was the surveilling mechanism that was responsible for, you know, the transfers of funds from one person's account to another, whether it's in the context of aggression or in the context of reparation? What does it mean to say that, you know, a nonprofit or a state-funded organization or something would be responsible for that, right? I don't necessarily know if it's that different from where we are now. It's just a different technological structure. Like, what does it turns reparations into hush money, right? The idea is that things don't need to change if we get paid, and that's not right. That's the problem, right? Reparations isn't about money. It's about change and repairing the system. So I said before that there are problems with this idea of financializing affect as a good thing, or there are problems with looking at it uncritically, right? And so I kind of wanted to talk more about the original context for claiming that unwaged work should be waged, which to my knowledge, I'm sure that there are other examples, but to my knowledge, the recent one that is important is the Wages for Housework campaign of the workerists in Italy in the 60s and 70s. This was a group of women that were arguing that the domestic work that people categorized as women do is work. It should be paid, right? What's funny, of course, is that most of them were white, and then they moved on to enter the market as things shifted toward informatic economies in the West. Women entered the workforce, specifically white women, and then they were able to hire black and brown women to do that domestic labor. So there actually did end up being wages for housework. They were just super fucking low. That's an example to me of how it can go wrong when we focus on the dollar amount as opposed to the conceptual position and what is allowed and afforded by thinking of something as worthy of a wage, right? When we do that, when we think of unwaged work as worthy of a wage, we're not saying pay that and we can keep things as they are. We're saying from this position, we can critique the concept as a form of governance, right? We can say that the wage, things like the wage or the freedom of information, et cetera, these kinds of concepts conceal the machinations of capitalism. So another example from that context, Sylvia Federici, who's one of the big Wages for Housework campaigners, as well as a really important materialist feminist, one of her mentors aside from a lot of Kenyan feminists, was Leopoldina Fortunati. She wrote a book called The Arcane of Reproduction. On page 98 or 99 of that book, there's a math equation. She has math in her critical theory book. And the equation is a calculation of the total surplus value of the unwaged work of people categorized as women. And then the question is, okay, so we calculate it, then what? We pay it off and it's fine, it's okay. So to me, that's a problem. Things, it's not about the dollar amount, it's about the concept, right? What does it mean to think about something that isn't seen as worthy of work as work, or not worthy of work, worthy of pay as work? I think that when you articulate the dollar amount in that way, it comes really close to just being the same kind of erasure or concealment of, you know, the systemic, the machinations of the system, right? So when we're talking about wages for internet presence, for example, like Laurel Patak took Sylvia Federici's text, Wages for Housework, from the 70s in 2013, I believe, and she edited the words housework for Facebook, right? So the idea was that she was saying that online activity was in a similar situation today as domestic labor was back then, right? Actually, I think it's the opposite. Digital labor today is in the same situation that domestic labor is in today, where Black and brown people, specifically women, are doing the cheap or unwaged work that keeps the system as it is, right? Their labor is what's actually making the internet fun to go onto. It's what's making the discourse fun to have, right? It's what's making, you know, the click farm labor in India, for example, the content moderators in Southeast Asia. Like, these are the actual people that are doing the low paid work that keeps the internet going. And when we talk about things like wages for Facebook, the idea that my activity, which is already subsidized by cheap labor, should be paid is absurd to me, honestly. So when we look at it from that angle, if we think back to the financialization of affect, right? And let's give an example. Crying should be waged. Every time you cry, you get money or something, right? Let's pick a very general example so we can see the problems clearly. when we take that position, we're concealing the politicality of our body, so to speak, right? So if we're saying crying should be waged, we're not talking about white tears at all, the psychological wages of whiteness, right? So when I say that we should recalibrate our position on the financialization of affect, I'm aware that there are problems with doing that, and that it can easily become hush money, or it can easily become a way of keeping the status quo as it is and paying people off, right? So I can move on now, or I can take some questions.
Anybody have any questions like that so far? Yeah, you can go ahead.
Cool. Let me try to be as clear as I can. I'm trying to shift now from this more general systemic discussion to describing the status of the individual body in this context. Oh, you know what I can do? As a good transition, I can read from my book. I'm going to read a poem called Race is the Way of the Real from my book, Transgender. Okay. I think the reason this is useful is because this poem talks a lot about financialization of affect, but it does it in a way that's funny. So the style of it is a good segue into talking about the individual, or the changing status of the individual, I guess, and how that relates to the illusion of the free, the illusion of the wage. Okay. Race is the money of the real. Hey, Elimayo. Like a coup in the distance, impending panic attack from a government form's length. The idea of being a citizen is depressing. The humor of Kafka or anything is the horrible fact of it being funny. My stomach turns on a dime. I puke out dead wings and bile. Real artists have hunger breath. It's been a slow give black people money month. Need to buy a replacement circular fluorescent light. Look at the gloating spider webs on the bomb. My PayPal is garageresidency@gmail.com. Trying to find out whether I dated a literal Nazi. Also, one of those mail order DNA tests sounds fun. Let me Google that for you. Tragic mulatto. I'm starting a new blog. It's about Wittgenstein's huge dick. I would kill myself, but like, I'm too cool, also too lazy. I can see your body tighten like a noose around dark skin. You see my light skin and think we are the same. We are not. You asked me to stretch you out, but suicide is expensive. Gender is expensive. Race is the money of the real. When the weed runs out, I feel death's chill. Okay. So why am I going to talk about individuals? It's relevant because the individual to me is probably the first sight of that tension between the real and the unreal, right? We each decide for ourselves at every moment whether the affect that we're putting on, the emotions that we're having, the ideas that emerge, we're at every moment we're struggling to calibrate that with the world around us. How real is this? How real am I? Etc. Or I do at least because I struggle with that a lot. Not only in a mental health thing, but just in general, I think that's the thing that people think about a lot and that I do. And so in this kind of antagonistic interaction that we have between our bodies and the world, the self is a kind of a connective tissue, right? The individual. But I think we're living in a time where the concept of individual has really shifted and the body isn't really, you know, an autonomous Western white male agent or aspiring to that. The body is more like a collection of data that can be endlessly subdivided and recombined and remixed. And I'm sure you all are familiar. That's a concept from Deleuze, the individual as opposed to the individual. I have a lot of problems with Deleuze, but we can use this concept of the individual, I think, in a useful way for talking about financialization of affect and that tension between real and unreal. I wrote in the description that reality itself is a kind of cash nexus, and this poem is called Race is the Money of the Real. The thoughts aren't fully clear in my head, but I think what I'm trying to argue is that race itself is that litmus for reality for lots of people. Like, I feel like when you're not white, especially when you're black, you're living in a world of fictions, and you're living in not only a world of fictions, but fictions that people believe in, right? And that's the scary part, is it's like, how did this happen? What kind of combination of data in this post-individualistic context allowed for this to happen, right? I think about that a lot. Like, how do people take that path? How do they get to that path? And how does the individual as a connective tissue get them there, right? And obviously that part of that is the fact that for white people, white's feelings are treated as more real, right? So that already from the beginning, the playing field isn't really even. And the concept of the real, unreal divide is racialized. But then I ask myself, what does it actually mean when we say race is the money of the real? Which is a quote from Alessandro Rango, this weird white theorist of black fungibility. What does she mean when she says that? That's a whole different question. What do I mean when I title my poem that, though? Because if race is the money of the real and reality itself is a cash nexus, then what does it actually entail when we say that people are paid due to race, right? People like Du Bois has that concept of the psychological wages of whiteness, right? I don't know. Again, like I said, the thoughts aren't clear in my head, so I can't articulate this, but I think there's something there. I have some maker's mark. I don't know how to open this stuff. It's got like a weird slime as a cap. Okay. Sorry.
Okay, so let's tie this all together though. Going back to this idea of the automated micropayments, right? Is it possible that that kind of structure, you know, this surveilling mechanism that pays you according to your affect, that takes money out of your account when you are an aggressor against people, when you do violence, is that a way of challenging the violence of the real unreal dichotomy, right? Like, will my feelings feel more real if I get paid for them? Like, do black feelings feel more real when you get paid for them, right? Can't open this shit. Sorry, my hands are really oily. This is so dumb. Okay, but seriously, all right. Right, so let's tie this all together. Will we feel more real as people of color, as black people, if our feelings are waged? No, right, of course not. I mean, our feelings are already waged. That's what I was talking about before. Affect is already financialized, right? And not only is it financialized, it's subsidized. All of our feelings are the results of this political system, and all of the products that we think are informatic are actually material. They're actually coming out of a violent industrial process. But then maybe we can look at the problems of the financialization of affect as a concept to come back to challenging the real unreal dichotomy, right? Like, maybe financialization of affect from the positive angle isn't the best way to challenge the real and the unreal dichotomy. If we look at it from the perspective of, no, it's not about the number, it's about the position, right? It's not about how much black folks get paid for our feelings. It's the idea that black feelings are worth a wage is a way of comparing them to the psychological wages of whiteness, right? And that comparison isn't allowed. And so when we actually are, when we move toward it, I think that we can critique utopianism better. And I'm trying to articulate why I think that is. Because I feel like that is. I feel like that's true. Okay. I'm gonna try to tie those together more later. I don't know if I'm doing a very good job, but I'd like to talk about some specific examples of artworks that have a reparative dimension in my mind, and of course that come out of the tradition that Damali Ayo started. And I mentioned a couple already, like Winslow LaRoche requesting donations on Facebook Messenger after they added the money feature. One of my favorites that started recently is Rafia Santana's Pay Black Time, if you guys have heard of it. It's a project that my friend Rafia started to get black people fed. She posts up links with really nice kind of graphic design elements to appeal to the visual learners. She puts up posters and stuff about, you know, the PayPal link and then the description of the project, and some of them have slogans like "You can make real change," right? Stuff like that, and it seems to have been working really well so far. I think about $7,000-something have traveled through the PayPal account, and a couple hundred orders have been made, maybe like 600-700 orders. So it's pretty amazing when you think about it. And I'm pulling up some text right now because I've actually written about this piece before, and I think it's worth me just giving it the respect and the articulateness that it deserves, the articulateness that I just don't have right now. Okay. Sorry, it's loading. Okay. So I'm just going to read. Pay Black Time is a project which Multimedia Brooklyn artist Rafia Santana began on the 9th of November 2016. The artist describes the project as, quote, my white money transference system that provides free meals via Seamless and Grubhub to black and brown folks across the North Americas. She goes on, all orders are paid for by the White Guilt Reparations Fund. For white people who ask, what can I do during a time when we have heavily publicized evidence of the racist direct connection to the continuous suffering and disenfranchisement of black and brown people worldwide, you can help in alleviating our stress by putting your money into the PayPal accounts I use for the delivery orders. When I asked by a Facebook chat whether Pay Black Time was art, Rafia responded, quote, I haven't thought of it specifically as art, but everything I do is art, I guess. While the project is thus in a limbo state, Santana says in an interview with Felt Zine that, quote, included in the structure of this project are several avenues of my art practice, graphic design, printing, crafting Facebook posts to reach more people, marketing, stencil making, public service. And it really interests me, as a side note, to see aesthetics kind of flattened into utilitarianism. I think that's awesome. Because aesthetics itself, if it's not helping black people and brown people, then it's just blackface. I mean, white art itself is a colonial theft of black and brown aesthetics to move away from figurative realism and three-point perspective. Like, that's really all it is. And so I love when a project, and I think all of the reparations projects do this, there are other works that do it too. I love when they flatten aesthetics into utilitarianism. I think it's really cool. In the same interview, Santana states that the project's name is, quote, a play on the phrase pay back time, and also a demand to pay back black people for the hundreds of years of free labor and continuing trauma in the US alone. It is time to pay back / pay black, unquote. In this way, the project not only offers white audiences an easy way to make concrete change, it translates the call for reparations into a service answering a need anyone could understand, that is hunger, and thus brings those people into the conversation of what America owes black people. And I think that's really cool because no one wants to let someone go hungry if they have the choice not to, right? The same way that Michelle Obama was trying to do a lot of homelessness activism, she started with the veteran population because it's easier for people to stomach that. The concept of unconditional free housing makes more sense to lots of people because, oh, well, they sacrificed their lives for the war machine, blah, 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 their broken souls. Right, and I think Rafia is doing a similar thing here by focusing on food, right? Reparations, obviously, it has so many dimensions to it. And if it was followed through to its logical conclusion, this world as we know it wouldn't actually exist, right? Reparations itself is actually an apocalypse, so the response of the apocalypse that is colonialism. But when we allow it to become more accessible, we can bring people into the conversation that otherwise wouldn't have had anything to do with it, right? And Damali was doing a similar thing. I have some problems with the way Damali was doing it because it has this, it kind of, you know, she's not homeless. She wasn't homeless back then. So why is it panhandling? What does that have to say about, I guess it's kind of a metaphor for black statelessness and the impossibility of black citizenship, but, you know, whatever. I'm not going to critique Damali. I love her. But in its banal fluidity between art and non-art, and its delegation of audience and aesthetics into potential financial utility in service of feeding people of color, Pay Black Time is an example of Winslow LaRoche's concept of post-art. I'm not gonna go into that in this talk, it will take way too long, but Winslow LaRoche is a genius, post-art is a cool concept. Post-art is, I'll briefly define it, it's a way of thinking about art that aligns with what I just described. It doesn't matter, it's irrelevant, it's white bullshit, it's colonial, right? That's post-art. Santana's project rejects the modernist premise of art's autonomous uselessness, which in reality is just complicity with white supremacist colonialism, a fantasy of escape from the constitutive violence of art and capitalism. Instead, Pay Black Time calls on its audience to recognize the aesthetic value in the concrete, useful act of paying for non-white people's food. Rendering aesthetics as simply utility reveals the covert utility of modernist arts concept, right? So the idea that art is useless, that was very useful for white artists. That was how they hoarded their resources and stole artifacts. And that's something, and they still do it. That's not in the past, it still happens. Rendering aesthetics as utility reveals the covert utility of modernism. which is the hoarding of resources stolen from conquest, which must be redistributed. Yeah, and wow, by November 9th, or by December 26th, she had $6,398.79 had moved through the account. She had done that many dollars in orders, which is amazing. So to me, that project is a good example of engaging the problems that I'm talking about with the financialization of affect. Hunger is not really an affect. Hunger is just a bodily, it's a physiological response. But I think the project kind of paves the way for some of these considerations about those problems. And another one that I want to talk about, and I'm just going to keep reading because this is the next section of this essay. And it's easier for me to read than talk because I'm bullshitting as I go along. But another project from a different angle of reparations is Wiki Africa. This is a project that's really special and I think deserves more attention. I don't think a lot of people know about it. I'm just going to read. Reparations also have an informatic and representational dimension, given the severing of historical continuity engendered by the Middle Passage. Indeed, the process of reparations is not just about money or about decolonization. It must include the repairing of the dialectic between Black America and Black Africa. This essay has concerned itself with the Middle Passage and its afterlife, but Africans who remain on their native lands also faced and continue to face violent colonization processes that exist in tandem with those of the New World, despite the lack of transatlantic slavery. So I'm trying to bring every Black person into the conversation about colonialism. I think that the discourse has really kind of been Americanized, and I say this as a Dominican who grew up in America. I think that to find more commonalities, like yes, Africans and Black Americans, there's this tension, just like there's this tension between Caribbeans and everyone else, but it's a generative tension. We can work through it and talk about all of the trauma that's been done and talk about strategies for coming together and decolonizing. So that's where I'm at. So one manifestation of African colonization from the dimension of informatics and representation is the rendering of Africa as invisible and inaccessible, which feeds into exoticism and primitivist stereotypes about the continent in the current pro-development neocolonial context. So when Africa is seen as this big bush up for grabs, it's just perfect for, you know, Chinese colonization, American investment in Uganda, stuff like that. Wikipedia is touted as a digital democratization of information, but it often exhibits mob mentality, and its acceptance requirements can be exclusionary of information and tone that do not fit the dominant paradigm. In particular, Wikipedia echoes the general lack of information online about Africa that one would expect from a digital sphere dominated by Western concerns. Africa is the world's third largest market and the most culturally diverse continent, and yet has the lowest and least informed profile of any region on the internet. Moreover, what does appear is often selective, lacks context, and reinforces outdated stereotypes. And I would add to this paragraph, Africa has, I think right now, the second biggest mobile market. I think China is the first. So Africa is online. They're just not allowed online, if that makes sense. As Tabitha Razer discusses in her video piece, Afro Cyber Resistance, the Cape Town-based collective Chimurenga experienced the controlling and geographically biased architecture of the internet. Quote, engaged in cultural African history and theory, Chimurenga tried multiple times to upload African content onto Wikipedia so as to Africanize the world's most visited online encyclopedia and fill the lack of information about the continent. Many of these proposed entries were rejected, some because their relevance was not proved, others because the style or tone of those entries was too personal or not deemed appropriate to the world's most open internet platform. Just in case you guys don't understand why this is relevant, this is an example of affect and gatekeeping and financialization, right? When Wikipedia says that a specific style or tone doesn't have informatic value, it's saying that it doesn't fit into the market, right? It's saying that this is not worthy of the attention economy. It's not something that people want to pay attention to. So no, it's not financialization, but pay attention kind of clues you into what's going on, right? There is an economy involved, and it's not financial, but it is still, I would say, extremely important. It's a libidinal economy, and so that's why I'm talking about this. because reparations isn't just about money. So I'll keep reading. Founded in 2007 by nonprofit Letter 27 and contemporary art platform Africa Center, Wiki Africa is a collaborative project aimed at generating content sourced from Africans for publication on Wikipedia. Acknowledging that Wikipedia's content restrictions are an accessibility issue, Wiki Africa conducts workshops and training, engages field experts, and deploys other initiatives such as Wiki Loves Women, to facilitate and encourage the publication of accurate, respectful information about Africa onto Wikipedia. Presumably, the project intends to exist in concert with efforts to increase African internet access overall, which in June 2016 consisted of around 340 million online users, or 28.7% of the population. In part due to this Africanization effort, as of 2017, which is when I wrote this, I guess, there are 67,561 articles within the scope of Wiki Project Africa, which is the major subwiki for the African Wikipedia content. The page states that this makes up 1.27% of the articles on Wikipedia and 1.74% of featured articles and lists. In total, in total, there are 234,896 pages in Wiki Africa subwiki. Obviously, there's a long way to go, but the production of true information about Africa, sourced from real Africans, navigating Wikipedia's oppressive informatic norms, is valuable groundwork for dispelling anti-African stereotypes and increasing online African representation. Since one dimension of reparations involves knowledge transfer and the violence of both invisibility and hypervisibility, Wiki Africa is a good rebuttal to the potential replication of anti-Black fantasies of Africa on cyber. Though Wiki Africa is a collaboration between a nonprofit and a contemporary art platform, it is not necessarily art, so it shirks aesthetic concerns to focus on the utilitarian project of Africanizing Wikipedia. As Tabitha Rezer states, even if this endeavor is not thought of or seen as internet art per se, it can be understood as an online platform for active social resistance against Occidental hegemony and online information control. The art/non-art fluidity of Wiki Africa is not new to the African scene, and neither is its treatment of aesthetics as secondary to utility. Tate Modern curator and scholar Elvira Dyangani Olse writes of how, in modernism's aftermath, 1960s African aesthetic desire, quote, went beyond the artworks they created, promoting critically the development of cultural initiatives whose goal was to blur disciplinary borders, powerfully influenced by vernacular cultures and languages, unquote. In the state of fluidity of work at the time, their participatory character was intended to provoke in the audience a political consciousness that went beyond aesthetic experience. And that beyond is really what interests me, both with the scope of Wiki Africa and Pay Black Time, and in the scope of this line of research that I've been talking about. Following this analytic frame, one could argue that African and Black diasporic post-art predate their white Western cousin, since the colonial condition engendered this fluidity between commodified art and ephemeral non-art. So Wiki Africa inherits this history of fluid participatory practice for social change. Okay, that was a little longer than I expected it to be, sorry. It doesn't matter, it's important, you guys should hear that. I have to charge my computer.
How do you feel about like asking some questions?
You guys can ask as many questions as you want.
Yeah, so questions for you want to clarify.
Sorry, you just cut out. What?
No, I was just asking people if they had any like questions or ideas that they wanted to clarify for you.
Mm.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's probably important. I'm not making too much sense. Like, let's be real. Cheers.
Should we, what do you think?
What?
Should we do a discussion?
Yeah.
Okay. Manuel, is there anything else that you wanted to like end with or?
I was trying in my head as I was reading to kind of tie everything together. Like I was hoping that the examples that I gave, Pay Black Time and Wiki Africa, maybe even Damali's too, not so much, but let's include her as well. I was hoping that these examples would be helpful in understanding how that financialization of affect plays into or is a part of this violent dichotomy between the real and the unreal. That's basically it. Yeah.
Cool. Yeah. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Manuel.
Thank you.
Yeah. Well, I'll.
Oh, should we stop? Okay.
Yeah. I think it's like, okay. It's like late in this time zone, so
mm-hmm.
You're in like the West Coast. So I think we're
it's early.
Gonna wrap up, but thank you so much.
Bye, Manuel.
Yeah, thanks for having me. I hope everyone has a good night. Take care.
Thank you. Bye. Bye.